Okay, so let's talk about some of the issues with floating point. So aside from its complexity, there are a lot of problems with floating point representations, and it's important to acknowledge those. And part of the reason we cover floating point representation in this course is that we want to give you some sense of caution about using floating point representations. They're quite useful, but they also have a lot of caveats that come along with using them. So the largest and sort of the most obvious is rounding error. So you only have a fixed width field, which means that if you have a fractional part that doesn't fit in the amount of space that you've allocated for it, you're going to have to round it off, and you're going to lose some of the bits of your answer. There is a particular quantity called machine epsilon that gives an upper bound on the rounding error of a particular operation. And one issue with this is not just that it happens, but that it tends to compound over time. So the longer a calculation runs, the more operations that it does, the rounding error tends to compound and accumulate in ways where it may not matter at the beginning, but it might become quite significant towards the end. Another issue is lack of associativity. So this is actually one of the things that we saw at the very beginning of the course. This was one of those surprising outcomes that I showed you at the very beginning, where if we have a very large number A and its negation B, and then a relatively small number C, you get different results if you add A and B first and then C, as opposed to if you had added B and C and then added A. And now we can understand sort of how that works, right? It's a result of the rounding error. If you add the smaller number to the larger number, the smaller number is too small. The actual change is beyond what can be represented in the fractional field. And so the change is lost, and you actually just end up with the same number. Which then when you add the negation of that large number gives you zero. Whereas if you had added those two numbers together, the number and its negation, then you'd have zero as that result, and then when you add the small number 3.14, you would still get that value. So that's what's happening with that example. And so what this means is that the compiler is not as free to rearrange floating point arithmetic as it is integer arithmetic, and this can prevent the compiler from being able to perform some of the optimizations that it normally would do for integer arithmetic. There's also an issue of cancellation. So this is the loss of significant digits during subtraction. So if you have a lot of digits that are the same, they'll cancel each other out and you have fewer significant digits than you had before. And maybe this is not a problem on this particular operation, but again, it's something that can compound over the course of a long series of calculations. Another problem with floating point numbers is that they're not evenly spaced like integers are. There are more floating point numbers closer to zero than there are further away from zero. And so adding a least significant digit adds more value if you have a higher exponent than if you had a lower exponent. There's actually a really great demonstration of this using Super Mario 64. There's a way of tricking the game to get you into a parallel universe that's far, far from the origin. And as you keep moving into these parallel universes that are further and further from the origin, the Mario character's behavior becomes more and more sporadic because you're moving between floating point values that are further and further apart in real space. So I highly encourage you go and watch this video that demonstrates this. It's a very real world and easy to understand outworking of this property of floating point numbers that they are not evenly spaced. Most of the time, most of the time there are enough numbers that you can know it, that this doesn't have a noticeable effect. But again, if you push some of these systems to their extreme, then it starts to cause problems. Another problem is that there are all these things called not a numbers. So remember we said that there were some bit patterns that were unaccounted for in that diagram that we saw earlier. Those are all things that are called nans or not a number. And if you divide zero by zero, this is what you're going to get. You're going to get something that is marked as not a number. And it's just a special value that the writers of the standard for this decided should encode something to indicate that it's not actually a number. One issue here is that this can propagate to later calculations, and eventually all of your values are just going to be NaNs, which is actually a nice thing because it generally indicates that something has gone wrong somewhere along the way. So in order to categorize a floating point number, mainly you look at the exponent. So if the exponent is not all zeros or all ones, then you just have a regular normal number. If it's all zeros, that means you have a denormalized number, again, meaning that it doesn't have a leading one in its significand. And if the exponent is all ones, then it's either infinity or a NaN. And you can tell whether it's infinity just by looking at the significand to see if it's all zeros. If it's all zeros, it's infinity. Otherwise, it's a NaN. And this is another thing to observe, which is that there are actually quite a lot of numbers that are reserved for these NaNs that kind of take up space in the encoding that could otherwise be used to store actual numbers. Another problem is that some numbers just can't be represented exactly regardless of how many bits are used. So for instance, the value 1/10 is a value that cannot be represented exactly in any binary fractional format, at least ones that doesn't use some sort of rational encoding. And so you end up with a repeating bit pattern that just repeats to infinity. And this is a problem that you should be familiar with. This is something that is still a problem in base 10. So for instance, you may remember learning that 1/3 is a quantity that can't be expressed exactly in base 10. It's just a repeating decimal number. So it's really the same sort of thing. It's just a little bit unintuitive because you're used to working in base 10, and so numbers like 1/10 that you're used to working with exactly are now approximate because the numbers are being stored in binary. So basically the rule of thumb is that if the number can be expressed as a sum of negative powers of the base, then it can be represented exactly. So can you form the number based on powers of 2? And if not, then you're going to have to approximate it. So hopefully this is all enough to make you cautious in using floating point numbers. You should still use floating point numbers when you need to approximate real numbers, but you should be aware of all these caveats, and you should constantly evaluate your results and how your program is running when you're using floating point. And if anything starts to look suspicious, hopefully this video has given you some ideas of where to look for where the problem might be.